I feel like I say the same thing every time. We're doing a project that I've been thinking about doing for a very long time. This is The Elder Scrolls III Morrowind from 2002. This game was very influential in my childhood, getting me into the fantasy genre, teaching me what good world building, good storylines are, how to integrate a fantasy fictional setting with real life themes, and quite frankly, history. In many ways, this is, in my opinion, one of the better Western RPGs that have ever come to gaming. And part of me just wants to listen to this music forever. Yeah, lots of nostalgia with this. Still, to this day, one of my favorite songs of all time is just the opening to Morrowind here. There's something very sweeping about the scope and choice of instruments in this piece that speaks at once to this like beautiful, like crescendoing grandeur, and also this mournfulness of like fallen or lost greatness, which embodies the Dark Elf homeland of Morrowind, which is of course the title. So at the very beginning, the story is fundamentally about history. The Elder Scrolls themselves are prophetic scrolls.
They have taken you from the Imperial City's prison, first by carriage and now by boat. To the east, to Morrowind. Fear not, for I am watchful. You have been chosen.
Wake up. We're here. Why are you shaking? Are you okay? Wake up. Stand up. There you go. You were dreaming. What's your name?
So, our first choice is the choice of our name. We could create one. We could take one from history. We could use the channel name. I've gone through lots of different kind of versions of that before, but really quickly I'd like to just talk about what just happened, because the text is very dense in the opening and many people start forgetting about the opening almost as soon as it just came. But we were spoken to in a dream by a female voice. If you know a lot about the history of the Elder Scrolls or the lore of this world, that might make more sense to you. I believe it's one of the tribunals. It's been very long time, like 18 years, since I have gone over this particular worldview. So we'll just keep an eye out there for some mystical, magical woman who's looking out for us on our quest. Personally, I think it's Alamextria. I think I'm saying her name correctly, but I don't know. What name could we go with? I guess that would determine, like, my idea is to make some kind of dark elf magic character here. I do like playing necromancers a lot, and I think necromancy is outlawed in Morrowind, but they have the ancestral spirit summon. For dark elf, I mean, their desert is kind of a homeland, so we could pick... Let's brush up on our Middle Eastern academics. Let's go with one of the greatest early Islamic historians, Tabari. Al-Tabari, 839 to 932. He's reputed to have memorized the Quran at the age of 7. There's also Ibn Musa al-Khawarizm. But Tabari sounds pretty good.
Well, not even last night's storm could wake you. I heard them say we've reached Morrowind. I'm sure they'll let us go. Quiet. Here comes the guard.
This is where you get off. Come with me.
Alright, so one of the first things that we know is that we're prisoner. Uh-huh. And in Elder Scrolls games, you often start at the very bottom of society, either controlled by the state physically, so that the idea is the movement isn't your choice, but you're quickly given choice after that, right? You're a prisoner at the moment of their freedom, which is a new start, right? It's a new life. It's a reason for you to be old while still not having anything and literally having nowhere to go but up. I mean, we could go back to jail, of course, but that would kind of be staying the same as where we were.
Get yourself up on deck and let's keep this as civil as possible.
Sneaking is just crouching. I kind of like E as my activation button, not spacebar, but we'll
see.
This
is where they want you. Head down to the dock and I'll show you to the census office.
I love that voice actor. He's great. Oh, wow.
Let's go. Move it along.
So we have a few mods installed. We have the code fix. We have, let's see, what do we have? We have Morrowind Rebirth, the patch, the code patch, and then we have MGEXE, which is basically graphics to get it into 1080p so that we're using all of the screen. And
you finally arrived, but our records don't show from where.
Okay, so again, one of the first things that we know about the NPCs in this world as our guards are Imperial guards. We are sent, you know, by order of the Emperor to this location to be a candidate for the prophecy that is foretold in the first opening credit scene. I actually really enjoy that aspect of prophecy, which is the prophecy always comes first, but you need a hero to do it. So people for a long time, or it's that idea that like Jesus Christ needed John the Baptist, right? Or John the Baptist prophecies for Jesus Christ. Before something happens, a lot of times, either politically or socially, there is a creation of an environment that allows that thing to happen first. So for example, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. isn't the first civil rights activist. He's standing on the shoulders of giants from the other civil rights activists that came before him. You know, Frederick Douglass, Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois. Each of these are working in different ways, often sometimes conflicting ways, to bring about change. So we're going to be a dark elf. I think because that just fits with kind of the narrative that I want to portray here is that dark elves are native to this region. My previous playthrough on Skyrim, I did high elf, but I've been going more towards mages lately, and I think we'll do kind of a female dark elf, some variety. Alright. And we'll give her... Yeah, I like that. Big, big hair. Oh, that one's pretty cool. I don't know, I like big hair. Big hair's pretty strong. Yeah, let's go with that. Big headdress.
Great. And I'm sure you'll fit right in.
So this
follow me up to the office and they'll finish your release.
Idea of his armor is obviously Roman-esque. Quite frankly, it looks Byzantine. The focus on horses as one of the primary force multipliers for militarism for humans, and also a symbol of wealth and power and status,
head on in,
is very Roman. Everyone loves a good chariot race. All right, so we got the tapestries over here. I believe this is the warrior, the mage, and the assassin. These are the constellations that you'll see in Skyrim as literally your leveling up menu, which I think is extremely stylistic, one of the best things that Skyrim ever did, and certainly was a jaw-dropper when it first came out. The initial instinct for every true Elder Scrolls player is to steal everything that you see, of course. We can't do that right now, although chest marked evidence lock level 50.
You'll go no further until you have your papers. All right.
So, right away, we can start reading. I normally am someone who reads all of these books just in my playthrough. I don't know if I'm going to do that whenever I'm streaming because it might be super boring, but to me, this is the way you play the game. You know, these early games from the 90s, or 2000s, but late 90s, are designed to be kind of like one of the few games that you owned, one of the few games that you had. Nowadays, everyone's Steam library is super full and they can't even find the time to play all of the games that they have. But, you know, let's just go through at least this one. Brief History of the Empire, Part 1. Should I read it out loud or should I let you guys read it? I think I'll read it out loud just to make sure I read it. Before the rule of Tiberius Septim, all Tamriel was in chaos. The poet Trazicus called that period of continuous unrest days of nights of blood and venom. The kings were a petty lot of grasping tyrants who fought Tiber Septim's attempts to bring order to this land. You know, not like Tiber Septim, who is going to literally be a tyrant. You know, the one victorious tyrant that actually wins, he's the one who brings order to the land. But the other ones who fail, those are just petty grasping tyrants, right? But they were as disorganized as they were dissolute. The strong hand of Tiber Septim brought peace forcibly to all of Tamriel, right? Whenever you see this stuff in history, you have to always read the subtext, right? One of the best things about the Elder Scrolls series is they include the author, right? Right up here. This is a text that is coming from somewhere and is going to somewhere, right? What is the few things that we know about the author right now is the Imperial historian Strongnok K. Thraj III, right? So there are a few things we can learn from this name. First of all, it's the third one of this name, right? So he clearly has a family that is in the habit of naming their people the same thing. This is usually in European circles or European history seen as wealthier families would often do this, right? Poor families are often called the job that they have, like somebody taker, a baker, or, you know, junior, or something of that nature. This is the third in a line. He is an imperial historian. He's probably rich, or at least he's well taken care of, and, you know, living at or near the palace. He's writing part one of a brief history, right? Which is one of the things that historians can be found guilty of is everything's really long because everything's really important and explaining it or putting it into detail. Lots of stuff happen in every year. So when you're talking about like hundreds of years, that gets real long, real fast. It's very hard to make a close history concise without leaving out things that the second you start learning history become egregious to you. They become horrible. You cannot leave out these stories and these people because they're so important. And it starts to hurt you to leave them out, at least for, in my experience, good historians. Alright, so this is just, you know, reading the text, right? Really, really reading it, paying attention to who is talking, what their job is, what their prospective audience is, and why they're saying the things that they're saying, and what motivations they have for that. Alright. The year was the second era, 896, right? So this is part one. He's starting it in the second era. He's not going back further than that, right? And who's his main character? It's Septim, right? Tiberius Septim. It's a history, not... It's a history of the Empire, but there's a lot of time before that that's just glossed over. He makes a literary reference to a poet, Trazicus. This also talks about the fact that there's probably not other good historians before this time period, otherwise he'd be referencing them, or at least not good historians that align with his political viewpoint. But what is there is poetry, right? And epic poetry is one of the first ways of studying and recording history that have ever existed, right? Before we have Thucydides or Plato or Aristotle, who do we have? We have Homer, right? We have the Iliad, we have the Odyssey. These are poems, these are epic poems, and it's one of the ways that humans like to keep track of things and, quite frankly, memorize long sections of dialogue and literature without having to write it down, because not a lot of people could write and not a lot of people could read. But everyone can listen and everyone can memorize, right? This is one of the things you see when you study slave culture and the Civil War, is they're really good at memorizing things. They can't write and they can't read, but their memory gets really sharp because that's what they need to survive in their environment. Okay, this is just the first page. We should probably move on from here. But that's why I like this game, is everything is genuinely deep. Following the Emperor declared the beginning of a new era, thus began the third era, year Oct. Maybe after August. Of course, August is a whole month that is named after a Roman emperor, Emperor Augustus, right? It's always important to remember how political everyone's calendar is, right? Monday, the Wednesday is Woden's Day, that's Odin's Day. Thursday, of course, is Thor's Day, that is the day of Thor. Freya's Day is Friday. Sunday is Sunday. that one stays the same, but many people don't notice that until you talk about it. Saturday is, of course, after Saturn. Saturn is a planet, but it's before that it was a, I believe, Roman god, I think is what Saturn is. Might be Greek. Might be Roman. I just want to look that up to improve my knowledge. Yeah, Roman religion. The Greek equivalent is Cronus. Oh, and the Etruscan equivalent is Satyr. The internet saves us again. I'm really glad to be an academic who was born into the burgeoning of the internet age. It's really been nice. So much information just at your fingertips. He's the god of generation, disillusion, plenty, wealth, agriculture, periodic renewal, and liberation. Saturn's mythological reign is depicted as a golden age of plenty and peace. After the Roman conquest of Greece, he was conflated with the Greek titan of Cronus. As Saturn's consort was his sister Opis, with whom he fathered Jupiter, Neptune, Pluto, Juno, Circe, Prius, and Vesta. Yep. Saturn's head is protected by a winter cloak, holding a sickle in his right hand, a fresco from the house Dioscerti at Pompeii in the Naples Archaeological Museum. Right, so he's the dad of Jupiter and Neptune. I think those Greek equivalents are Zeus and Poseidon. And Pluto, who is Hades, or close to Hades. Interesting that they took it as the Roman perspective going to Greece. That's when he gets conflated with Cronus, rather than the Greece perspective going to Rome. So they mark the transfer of cultures at the Roman conquest of Greece, when histories that I've read previously mark the transfer at the Greek inception of it being absorbed by Rome through their activity in the Peloponnesian War in Sicily. But that's just me. Okay. so let's keep going. Alright. For 38 years, the Emperor Tiber reigned supreme. It was a lawful, pious, and glorious age when justice was known to one and all, from serf to sovereign. Alright, so 38 years. How old do you think this person is when they start ruling? Right? And how old could they be when they finally conquer stuff, right? When you look at some of the greatest military leaders in history, either Napoleon or I don't know, Alexander the Great, right? A lot of them start off in their 20s, right? Pretty young, because they have a lot of energy. But when they finally do win, you know, getting old or growing old with a successful reign is a lot harder in some ways than getting the successful conquest in the first place. So yeah, 38 years, right? That's almost 40 years. He was probably over 20 when he started this. So, you know, somewhere in his 60s at this point. Also, the imperial historian is the first one to assure you that it was a lawful, pious, and glorious age. You know, of course, we can always trust the imperial historian. When justice was known to one and all from serf to sovereign, on Tiber's death it was rained for an entire fortnight as if the land of Tamria itself was weeping. But there is magic in this world, so that might be an okay assumption, right? This idea of, you know, the imperial historian making these glorious overludes to the founding fathers, right? You know, that would never happen in American literature. American historians would never be guilty of holding up George Washington to be this perfect, flawless being. Even if they did genuinely a good job, you still get, you know, this hero worship of the first, you know, honestly, tyrant, right? He's just a successful tyrant. The Emperor's grandson, Pelagius. Having your name right next to Plague is never a good idea, but Pelagius. Pelagius, I believe, is also a Greek name. Came to the throne. Or is it Roman? It might be Roman. They're just, I mean, Tiber and Septim. Septim is literally both Roman names. This reign was short. He was strong and resolute as his father had been, and Tamriel. So also it's important to note, septims are the currency in this world. Every gold coin is called a septim, right? It's called a, because that's the stamp of the head or name that's on it. This is something that also pops up in history a lot. People will develop shorthand for the currency that's kind of like a political convenience when the currency starts becoming new, and then as the currency takes over and becomes dominant, then that will stay and become the normal lingo, right? Greenbacks, what's it? There are lots of examples. I can't think of them right now to do like an appropriate history of coinage and currency, although it's very important for everyone to always go back and study money. Study the thing that the world runs on in history. It gives you lots of horrific and also very important insights into economics, and especially Britain in the 1800s and 1700s, taking over most of the world's financial institution, and shortly followed by America, at least for the West and capitalism. All right, though his reign was short, he was strong and resolute as his father had been, and Tamriel could have enjoyed a continuation of the Golden Age. Alas, an unknown enemy of the Septim family hired that accursed organization of cutthroats, the Dark Brotherhood, to kill the Emperor Pelagius I as he knelt at prayer in the Temple of the One in the Imperial City. Temple of the One, that's important. Many places in this world have polytheism, and emperors always like monotheism because it reinforces the centralization of power and authority. So you have it in the political realm and you mirror it in the religious realm. Ra is an important touchstone for this, for Egypt, as well as the European phenomenon of divine rule. Although China and Japan and Korea, especially North Korea modernly, and Japan in World War II, and China just throughout their entire history also have this religious association with their divine rulers. But, you know, they also somewhat tolerate the existence of polytheism in the ambient world around them, especially nature deities. or deities of other locations, but when it comes to politics, you really have that one god narrative, or one divine son, or one representative of the divine will on the planet take over. There can't be more than one divine. It's very hard to have political stability when you have more than one divine person being on your planet at the same time. Okay. So interesting, Dark Brotherhood, one of the first times we ever hear this name, at least in Elder Scrolls 3, is killing the Emperor, right? The highest level of assassination that you can imagine. I wonder, in Skyrim, do you ever have to do that? I don't know if you do. I mean, it's one of the best jobs that the Dark Brotherhood could get, right? Killing a king. I seem to remember there's something on a boat somewhere, but I have to replay Skyrim's Dark Brotherhood to make sure. I like the wedding one, killing the people at the wedding. That was funny. All right. Plagueis the First reign lasted less than 3 years. Ooh, not great. Plagueis had no living children, so the Crown Imperial... Really? No living children? Huh, I find that somewhat hard to believe. I bet those children were illegitimate. So the Crown Imperial passed to his first cousin, the daughter of Tyvar's brother, Aghanorith. Gee, I wonder if Aghanorith, might have ordered the assassination. You know, whenever you're looking for who... They don't speak to why at all in this history. They don't say, hey, who... Why was this person killed? That never comes up. The daughter of Tyvar's brother, Aghanorith, Kintara, former queen of Sylvanar, assumed the throne as Kintara the First. Her reign was blessed with prosperity and good harvests, and she herself was an avid patroness of art, music, and dance. Kintara's son was crowned after her death. Okay. We don't get any dates on these deaths. We get 3 years. Okay, actually, so 3 years, 38 years, so we're somewhere in 920, and then 3 years after that, so mid-1925. Yeah, we don't know how long this lasts, but it's her son. Crowned after her death, first Emperor Tamriel to use an imperial name, Uriel. Uriel the First was a great lawmaker of the Septim Dynasty and promoter of independent organizations and guilds. Okay, so setting up the society that we are familiar with today, mostly, honestly, guild and organization focused. There's some companies, but it's not strictly capitalist. Guilds are really the big movers and organizers of power in this world. Quite frankly, it's very feudal. If you look at, workers' guilds, masonry guilds, architects' guilds, at any time from like before the 1700s, really, those are the main organizers of land-based power. Internationally, companies start taking over with Britain. Just because they're dealing with so much trade and money, and quite frankly, their ships got good enough to do it. All right. Under his kind but firm hand, the Fighters Guild and the Mages Guild increased in prominence throughout Tamriel. Fighters and mages, always good. His son and successor, Uriel II, reigned for 18 years. From the death of Uriel in Third Era 64. Oh, I see. So they would have started a new era, and then that resets the numbers. Okay, to Plagueis II's ascension in 82. Tragically, the rule of Uriel II was cursed with blights, plagues, and insurrections. Jesus. That's rough. The tenderness he inherited from his father did not serve Tamriel well, and little justice was done. A weak king. History loves nothing more than a weak king. Lagus II inherited not only the throne from his father, but the debt from the latter's poor financial and judicial management. Isn't that always the way? You got the sins of your father bearing down on your finances. Lagus dismissed all of the Elder Council and allowed only those willing to pay great sums to resume their seats. Ooh, jeez. Pay to play. He encouraged similar acts among his vassals and the kings of Tamriel, and by the end of his 17-year reign, Tamriel returned to prosperity. Okay, so he did salvage the debt, but at the cost of putting himself in debt politically, in the sense of owed favors to all of these nobles. So whenever you have a weak king relative to the nobility, which usually means that the federal government or the kingdom is poor and the nobles are rich, if that makes any sense to you, then the nobles gain a lot of power by bailing out the kingdom from its debt, right? So now you trade these political favors for money, and then later they try to trade the political favors back for money, right? It's why you hire good accountants, you try not to do corruption, you try to do things that make sense, because at the end of the day, people need money to live. And if you're a nobleman, you need money. If you're a poor person, you need money. If you're a king, you still need money. Many kings solve this by just going to war somewhere else from a different kingdom and taking all of their riches and using that to fill their coffers. But that's if you're not... if you're weak and if you don't want to go murder a bunch of people and conquest things, then that's one of the solutions. You could also just create a debt system and a stock market, which can artificially create value for you. Or do what the British did and create the Hollow Sword Company and fabricate an entire trade company that is valued massively and get all of your local parliamentary higher-ups in the government to invest in that, thereby funding the government for kind of an amount of time until people find out about it, and then the bubble collapses. Alright, he encouraged similar acts among his vassals. The kings of Tamriel, he reigned for 17 years, got out of debt. His critics, however, have suggested that any advisor possessed of wisdom but not of gold had been similarly ousted by Plagueis. And that's true. I mean, you have to have kind of both. Ideally, you want both. Always. You know, you could be really, really smart, but if you can't pay your tuition, sorry, you don't get your degree. This may have led to some of the troubles that his son Antiochus faced when he in turn became emperor. So I actually really like this organization. Oh shit. Did I take that? Wait, is it still here? I don't have an inventory yet, do I? Okay, so... Stormok, you know, is limited in some ways by being an Imperial Historian, but we can gain that this perspective of problems being passed down from one generation to another is a pretty good commentary for political financial stuff. If you look at what Uriel did in order to get into debt, it might have been fully funding the startup of these organizations and guilds. He's a kind of a firm hand, buyer's guilds and major's guilds. Like, I'm sure that wasn't done without assistance from the king. And also just like... if you just have a run of bad luck and you get where is it? Blights, plagues, and insurrections. That's expensive, right? So it takes one generation can have to be paid for by many, many, many other generations. You know, lots of people are saying we're still living with the effects of the Great Recession, and now we have what is functionally another recession in the COVID crisis, which is a global phenomenon and event, and no one is really aware yet of how that financially is going to affect everyone, when the world just kind of stops turning for a year or more. It certainly affected my life in horrible economic ways. So that's a plague, right? That's what plagues do to your global economy. We have a first-hand look at that right now in this year. All right, Antiochus. Antioch is a city from the Crusades, I believe. It's a coastal city. I believe it's one of the cities that you go to in the first Assassin's Creed. If you play Total War 2, you can... Total War Medieval 2. Their Crusades expansion is also in that area. There's an Antioch International Movement of Churches. Antioch City. It's a city in California, but I want the one that's in the Middle East. It's an ancient Greek city on the southern side of the Orontes River. It's in Turkey. Yep, it's the very, very south part of Turkey. Right before you get into Lebanon, I believe. It's a big, important city for the Crusades. Antioch becomes the first city to formally apologize for past misdeeds to Chinese, May 18th, 2021. The Chinese tunnels of downtown Antioch. Interesting. There is a Chinatown down there. That's next to houseboats. I think this is in California. Okay, let's not get too distracted. Was certainly one of the more flamboyant members of the usually austere Septim family. He had numerous mistresses and nearly as many wives. Wow, nice. And he was renowned for the grandeur of his dress and his high good humor. Unfortunately, his reign was rife with civil war, surpassing even that of his grandfather Uriel II. The War of the Isle in the Third Era of 110, 12 years after Antiochus assumed the throne, nearly took the province of Somerset Isle away from Tamriel. Ooh, wow. Okay. Yeah. I mean, high elves, yo. They absolutely resent the imperial rule. They're always so arrogant anyway. Speaking from a human perspective. The United Alliance of the Kings of Somerset and Antiochus only managed to defeat... Alliance of the Kings of Somerset and Antiochus only managed to defeat King Olgrim of the island kingdom of Pianodonica due to a freak storm. Interesting. Wow. Legend credits the Sigic Order of the Isle of Aratarium with the sorcery behind the tempest. Okay, so the Sigic Order comes into play a lot in Skyrim in relation with the Mage's Guild, but here we see it early on mentioned in, you know, literally the history books in Morrowind. The story of Kintera II heirs her father's Antiochus' throne is certainly one of the saddest tales in imperial history. Her first cousin Uriel, son of Queen Potema of Solitude, accused Kintera of being a bastard, alluding to the infamous decadence of the imperial city during her father's reign. Yeah, probably. When this accusation failed to stop her coronation, Uriel brought... Her first cousin Uriel, brought the support of seven disgruntled kings of Hyrok, Skyrim, and Morrowind, and with Queen Potema's assistance, he coordinated three attacks on the Septim Empire. Jeez. Yes. Yeah, see, that would be rough. I wonder if these are from the other games earlier. So let's just unpack this. So the first cousin Uriel, Queen Potemma of Solitude. Huh, Solitude. Shoot. Solitude comes up. Doesn't it? Sylvanar, okay. So I guess this is the first time that we hear Solitude enter into the history. Solitude will come into prominence later. I think that's in Skyrim, isn't it? The first attack occurred in the Iliac Bay region, which separates High Rock and Hammerfell. So that is northeast. Hammerfell is where the black people come from, for lack of a better term, the Red Guards. And High Rock is the home of the Bretons, right? So both kind of western, northern, other strong, proud human races. Kintyre's entourage. Also, High Rock has always had connections with the elves, the High Elves of the Isle, because they're also on the west, and they're both aligned with magic very heavily. So that could be a consequence, kind of a political echo of that region fighting the Imperial region. Kintara's entourage was massacred and the Empress taken captive. For 2 years, Kintara II languished in an Imperial prison, believed to be somewhere in Glenport or Gamorrel. Glenpoint or Glenmorrel. Jesus, this is horrible. Before she was slain in her cell under mysterious circumstances. Maybe she committed suicide, or maybe she got someone to kill her. I mean, keeping someone in prison for 2 years... Man, that sucks. Politics is pretty bad. Yeah. The Game of Thrones, you win or you die. And she died. She was killed in prison. The second attack was on a series of Imperial garrisons along the coastal Morrowind Isles. Oh wow, that's where we are. The Empress's consort, Kontin Aranix, fell defending the forts. The third and final attack was a siege on the Imperial City itself, occurring after the Elder Council was split up and the Elder Council had split up the army to attack Western High Rock and Eastern Morrowind. Jeez. Okay, so the Elder Council kind of made a play here to split the army and attack the people who are doing this. So High Rock and Eastern Morrowind. This weekend the government had little defense against Uriel's determined aggression and capitulated after only a fortnight of resistance. So a month siege. Uriel took the throne that same evening and proclaimed himself Uriel III, Emperor of Tamriel. The year was the third era, 121. Thus began the War of the Red Diamond, described in volume 2 of this series. Okay. Yeah, I want to own these books. They seem extremely important. Surprise, surprise, I think history's important.
Yes, we've been expecting you. You'll have to be recorded before you're officially released. There are a few ways we can do this, and the choice is yours.
Awesome. So, answers questions, generates classes. Given the info, you can pick a class for list, or we can kind of power game it and do that. I don't know what we should do in terms of power gaming. I want to do the questions just because I think they're interesting psychological evaluations. They're also very, you know, I think it's a staple of this genre to do them. So I like doing them. Even if we don't select the class ultimately that we're going to have, because quite frankly, a lot of these classes have inefficiencies in them, right? They have Unarmored, for example. Morrowind is celebrated widely for being one of those games that has a bunch of different stats, like spear, for example, is different than two-handed. Hand-to-hand is here. light armor, medium armor, and heavy armor here instead of just light armor and heavy armor like is in Skyrim. It's much more granular and detailed, and Skyrim kind of took that system and simplified it a lot. So one of the things I want to do with Morrowind is enjoy those little aspects of granularity. And we could do a spear and medium armor build. I think that would be pretty fun. So let's go with this first acrobat. Stealth. I kind of want to stay away from the stealth archer stereotype here in the beginning. Mostly magic is going to be my ranged attack, although getting out of sneak in the Elder Scrolls series is very hard to do. Sneak is just a really important skill. Agent. Pretty close. Mercantile's up here. I like that. Conjuration. Personality first, then agility. Stealth is the specialization there. Archer. Yeah. Assassin. Pretty cool class. Got the boots. The way these pictures change is always one of my favorites. Barbarian. Look at that. Got all the weapons. Blunt weapon. Axe. Getting redundancies in the differences between blunt weapon and axe is, I don't know, it's kind of something I get that they simplified for Skyrim, you know, but I don't know, it still felt good to have a specialty, have like a narrow specialty. Alright, bard. Got a little mandolin there. I wish you could kind of play music in this. Battle Mage, pretty good. Crusader. Combat, willpower. Healer. Healer is, you know, pretty appealing to me, to be honest. Hand to hand as your major skill. They only damage fatigue at a standing opponent, but hand-to-hand attacks damage health when the target has been knocked unconscious by fatigue loss. So you knock them down first, and then you kill them. Very interesting. I don't know if we have the health to do that. Very interesting build, though. Unarmored. I don't know. Healer's an attractive group there. Having unarmored and light armor seems a little strange, though. Knight. Longblade, axe, speechcraft, heavy armor block, restoration, mercantile, medium armor, enchant armor. So we do have Morrowind Reborn, which is a balance patch as well for the game. Mage, this is more my jam here. Mysticism, Destruction, Alteration, Illusion. I'd like Conjuration to be a major skill, but, you know. There's also kind of the ways to game the system that I have to look up later about how to get the best stats, quote-unquote, is like you don't put your major skills as the skills that you actually want to use, at least in Oblivion. So that when you were ready to level up, you had the maximum bonuses to your stats. But to be honest, if I was going to worry about that, I would just honestly just take the level cap off. You know what I mean? Like, the only reason that you min-max the whole game is so that because you're capped at level 20... And so when you hit level 20, not being able to grow means that you could find yourself very low statted early on, or at the top end of the game. I don't really want to, like, worry too much about it. And I'd rather just roleplay what my major skills actually are, genuinely. Nightblade. Interesting that specialization is magic for Nightblade. Seems like it's very close to Assassin up here, but... Security is a minor skill, sneak marksman, light armor, short blade, acrobatics. And this is pretty much all stealth mage, which is kind of what we're going to do, or we're going to end up doing. Pilgrim, stealth. More just like the... I don't know, there's a lot of block and short blade. Creation, marksman, mercantile, speechcraft. Playing this would be nice. Rogue being a combat-only class, I think, is very interesting. Not a lot of the soft skills here, mostly just combat. Scout. Personality, I guess, for the rogue. Scout is just an even more combat-focused kind of light warrior. Scout could be good if we wanted to go into the Fighter's Guild. And there's Sorcerer, one of my favorites also. Where else did you go? We went Dark Elf. Dark Elf, female, I'm thinking going Witch or something along those lines. Spell Sword, also very good, mix of combat and magic. Thief, of course, just about the money. Even more into stealth skills, less into combat. Warrior, just combat. Heavy armor, medium armor. Marksman, spear, armor, axe, blunt weapon. Yeah. And then Witch Hunter. I like Witch Hunter a lot, to be honest. It fits a lot with my personality. Conjuration being a major skill is great. And alchemy, light armor, marksman. Maximum size, lowest damage, fireballs. There you go. Unarmored, block, blunt weapon, sneak, mysticism. Yeah, I mean, I put on some mods. The graphics mod and the bug fix mod and the Morrowind Reborn mod, which gives better... what's it? Like, it makes new towns, new cities, and adds quests and, like, flushes everything out. It's a big mod, so I hope it doesn't... Yeah. Baldur and I used to... make spells that, or rather, Baldur almost exclusively engineered these like Frankenstein-esque, like mad genius spell combinations that really pushed the boundaries of like what you could do with the game at a time when like that was very young, that was very new in gaming. And he would go fly up to Balmora and just center a huge fireball with a radius of the entire city on the center of the city and get every single person to aggro onto the flying form of my little brother flying up there.
On a clear day, you chance upon a strange animal, its leg trapped in a hunter's claw snare. Judging from the bleeding, it will not survive long. What do you do?
I interfere with the natural evolution of events, but rather take the opportunity to learn more about a strange animal that you've never seen before. Okay. Use herbs from your pack to put it to sleep, or draw your dagger mercifully, ending its life with a single thrust. Ooh. This is hard. I mean, there's no option to save it. To save the animal. That's what I want. I think putting it to sleep? I guess...
One summer afternoon, your father gives you a choice of chores. What would you rather do?
Work in the forge with him casting iron for a new plow, or go catch fish at the stream using a net and line. Oh. Yeah, a Turing test. I would like to fish. Gather herbs for your mother who's preparing dinner. Fishing seems most fun. Working at the forge is like... That seems hard and dangerous.
Your cousin has given you a very embarrassing nickname, and even worse, likes to call you it in front of your friends.
No
You've
shit.
Asked him to stop, but he finds it very amusing to watch you blush. What do you do?
Beat up your cousin. Tell him that if he ever calls you that nickname again, you will bloody him worse than this time. Dude, that's fucking sociopathic. Violence is the solution to my problems. Make up an even more embarrassing nickname for him and use it to constantly until he learns his lesson. I don't know. That seems mean. Like, Make a story that makes your nickname badge of honor instead of something humiliating. Yeah, that's what
there
I would
do.
There
is a lot of heated discussion at the local tavern over a group of people called telepaths.
You mean the Psijic Order?
They've been hired by certain city-state kings. Rumor has it these telepaths read a person's mind and tell their lord whether a follower is telling the truth or not. You believe what?
If you have nothing to hide, then you have nothing to fear. America. Maximum patriotism here. And also a severe violation of individual rights. It's important to have a method for finding assassins and spies before it's too late. Funny enough, in a speech and debate round for extemporaneous speaking, I actually did take this opinion as a meme for monitoring people's emails from the government with the NSA, which was very new at the time. This was, I believe, 2006 when this happened. It was a terrible practice. A person's thoughts are his own. No one, not even a king, has the right to take such an invasion of a human's mind. Yeah, kind of. Yes. During these times, it's a necessary evil. In these times, no true Scotsman would ever use the true Scotsman fallacy. But yeah, the appeal to there being some sort of uniqueness about this time period relative to any other time period, or this location's political dangers as opposed to every other political dangers, is a common fallacy that you see used a lot in political history, and also in the modern time. So it's really funny to see different people through time using the same argument when to them their time period isn't special and is history, but they keep on appealing to their peers at the time as if it is. It's really great, and it's one of the gifts that studying history gives you, is the fact that you can call their bullshit and be like, oh, hey, you too will eventually flow to the sands of time. You will not be special. Let's go with this.
Your mother
individual
sent you
rights
to the
and individual
market
privacy.
With a list of goods to buy. After you finish, you find that by mistake, a shopkeeper has given you too much money back in exchange for one of the items. What do you do?
So this has actually happened to me, and I went back and gave the error for the money, but I think this also, like so many of these questions, are tests of how rich you feel, right? It's like morals are something that you can afford whenever money is involved. So if you are starving to death, you literally need that money to live, and that's just something that they can like write off on their business insurance. Or that it's not, and the company doesn't have enough money to hire the workers. It depends on the company. Is the company a large mega corporation to which money is literally like non-existent functionally at a certain level? Or are they like an individual person who's just struggling to get by and create a livelihood? How rich do you feel, I think, is the question that's being asked here. I don't know. Decide to put the extra money to good use and purchase items that would help your family. I mean, kind of. It depends on how rich your family is. Pocket the extra money, knowing the shopkeepers in general tend to overcharge customers anyway. I mean, they have a profit margin that they hit, but that profit margin is flexible based on what the other people will pay. And they're always testing that boundary, because that's what business is... whatever the agreed upon price is, that's what people pay for it. And finding that price is, quite frankly, a matter of social manipulation and expectation manipulation. I'm going to do this one.
While in a marketplace, you witness a thief cut a purse from a noble. Even as he does so, the noble notices and calls for the city guards. In his haste to get away, the thief drops the purse near you. Surprisingly, no one seems to notice the bag of coins at your feet. What do you do?
So leave the bag there, knowing it's better not to get involved, is like not taking a risk. It's basically how risk averse are you. Pick up the bag and pocket it, knowing that the extra windfall will help your family. He is a noble, so he has that money, you know. He's not hurting for money. Again, I think this is a question of how poor do you feel. I don't know how the game is organizing this. I think it's just how much stealth attributes do you want in your stuff versus how much like honorable fighter stuff do you want, maybe. But I don't know. If he's a noble, and we know he's a noble, I think it's this one. Pick up the bag, sit on the guard, knowing that the honorable thing to do is to return the money to its rightful owner. I don't give a fuck about honor. Honor gets you killed a lot, and honor is for people who can afford it in lots of ways.
Your father sends you on a task which you loathe, cleaning the stables. On the way there, pitchfork in hand, you run into your friend from the homestead near your own. He offers to do it for you, in return for a future favor of his choosing. What do you do?
I mean, it depends on how, if he's your friend or not. You run into your friend, I think that you would want to help him. Accept his offer, reasoning that as long as the stables are cleaned, it matters not. No. Like, you need to... There's dangers to being that lazy. And also, like, just have some maturity and wisdom to do things that are hard, even if you don't want to do them. Decline his offer, knowing that your father expects you to do the work. It's better not to be in debt. I don't know. Like, cooperation, I think, is the best policy here. Ask him to help, knowing that two people can do the job faster than one, and agree to help him with one of his tasks in the future. Yeah, if he's your friend, why wouldn't you want to help him in the future?
Your mother asks you to help fix the stove. While you're working, a very hot pipe slips its moorings and falls towards her. What do you do?
Listen to yourself between your fives to your mother. Okay, so... I don't know. Push your mother out of the way? That seems like that would solve the problem. Grab the hot pipe and push it away. I don't know. Like, I think push your mother out of the way. That way you both get saved, right? I'm sure that's the stealth thing to do. This might be the fighter thing to do. Or maybe both of these are fighter things. I think you just push your mom away.
While in town, the baker gives you a sweet roll. Delighted, you take it into an alley to enjoy, only to be intercepted by a gang of three other kids your age. The leader demands the sweet roll, or else he and his friends will beat you and take it. What do you do?
Drop the sweet roll and step on it, then get ready for a fight. Seems just spiteful. Now no one gets a sweet roll. And you get a fight. You really want to fight directly. You're outnumbered, though. Three other kids your age. I've never had a body type that would make that a good idea. Give him the sweet roll now without argument, knowing later this afternoon you'll have all your friends with you and you can come and take whatever he owes you. That sounds better. You might get something better than a sweet roll there. Act like you're going to give him a sweet roll, but then at the last minute, throw it in the air, hoping that they'll pay attention to it long enough for you to get a shot in at the leader. Well, then you're on a 2v1 situation, and it might not even work. And throwing it into the air also doesn't get you the sweet roll. So, at this point, it's just about fighting. I think this has the best chance.
Entering town, you find that you are witness to a very well-dressed man running from a crowd. He screams to you for help. The crowd behind him seems very angry. What do you do?
So this is kind of individualism versus mob rule. The rights and needs of the many versus the rights and needs of the few. I don't know. There's many ways to view this. One of them is that this well-dressed person, right, who's... The idea is there's money involved in the narrative here, or social position involved in the narrative here. The thing is, like, if it was just one person chasing him and he was rich, that would be kind of a different story because, like, well, it helped the poor person, right? And as that number gets bigger for the poor people, it becomes more and more likely that you'll help the one versus the many, right? Because of individualism and individual rights. But the truth of the situation is he just pissed off more people, you know? He's not, like, he didn't do anything worse or better than what he would have done, or rather, if it was one person chasing him, the thing he did must have been or could have been worse, so that he didn't just piss off one person, he pissed off a lot of people. So part of me wants to help out the mob here. Not get involved. I don't know. You don't know anything about this situation. Like, you really don't know. He's screaming to you to help, but he could be a bad person. Clearly, I don't know, even if he is a bad person, like, you should still have, like, proper justice. Rather than, like, defending someone from lynchings. Town aid or man's aid? Ah, fuck. I think man's aid at least... Well, because you're in danger too. They could turn on you. I mean, you just don't know. Yeah, I think you don't have the information. Witch hunter. Ooh. Nice. Do love witch hunter. Let's take that. Let's make... I mean, I don't want to be the witch hunter, though. I want to be the witch. You know what I mean? Like... Intelligence agility or intelligence willpower? Maybe luck. That'd be funny. I mean, witches, I think it is willpower. Major skill... Is it mysticism? What is a witch's first skill? I think it is mysticism. Maybe it's alchemy. Mysticism. Alchemy. Restoration. Be a good witch. Illusion. Alteration. Yeah. I think that's correct for witches. Unarmored. Should I do an unarmored build? It'd be so hard. And I need defenses. Conjuration for sure. Destruction. Yeah. And enchantment. Yep. And then, let's see, witches, what other things do they have? Unarmored, maybe? I mean, wow, this is gonna be hard. Yeah, I guess we're just taking the whole magic thing here. I don't know. I guess light blade, right? I think we're gonna have to go classic. Just super classic here. Short blade. Daggers, tanto, short swords. Yeah, I mean, I think it's this. Oceans. Inspiration. Alteration, illusion. I don't know. I kind of want conjuration here. Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Very good.
We're
the
witch.
Letter that preceded, you mentioned you were born under a certain sign. And what would that be?
Was I? So this is also one of the times we'll see Morrowind Reborn, is they rebalanced this stuff. Weakness to magic of 50%. Oh my god, Elfborn. Maybe. Spell absorb 25 points. Fortify maximum magicka. Oh, okay, even more magicka. But stunted magicka. What does stunted magicka do? I don't like what that means, stunted magicka. Fortify personality, endurance, charm. Nice. Weakness to fire. There's some spells here. Fortify health. Lover, fortify agility, 20 points. Paralyzed kiss for 10 seconds on target. Just like real livers. Paralyzed is strong as fuck, though. That'd be cool. Yeah? I mean, mage seems good, but weakness to magic of 50%. 1.5. Int. Turn undead. Ooh, nice. Our health. Poison 5 points for 10 seconds on touch. And cure poison on self. Visibility 30 seconds. Always a strong one. Chameleon 25. Fortify speed. Always useful. Feather 100 points for 60 seconds. Feather's useful as hell. Sanctuary. I'm not sure what Sanctuary does. 10 points. Fortify luck. The tower. Okay. Open 75 points on touch. Collect 25%. And the warrior. I don't know. Mage seems good. This seems like, quite frankly, very dangerous. Interesting. But also dangerous. I don't know. I think it's mage. I don't wanna do weakness to magic of 50% for my entire life. Like, that just seems like a way to get one shot. Alright.
Interesting. Now, before I stamp these papers, make sure this information is correct.
Alright. Now, both. Okay. Interesting that you start with these spells if you get the magic up there already. I wonder if you get them just by starting at a certain level. You know what I mean? Unarmored. I mean, it means we're gonna have to get magic robes or something. I'm not sure about this. I'm not sure about that. We're gonna have to take some damage for unarmored to really work for us. You now have a stats menu, thank God, where you can always do your information. Right-clicking allows you to use your menus. When you're done with them, right-click again
to close them. Show your papers to the captain when you exit to get your release fee.
My release fee? Pressing spacebar while looking at them, and select take to pick them up. Alright. For the release by Uriel Septim, the Seventh Decree, the District of Varvenfell. Tokus Igalia, agent of Sedanine Imperial Census and Excise. Alright. Sure. Like all menus, right click to use your new menu. You can click to move objects from the world to your inventory. Whoa. Oh, wow, okay. We are the Imperial Legion. We swear our lives and unyielding loyalty to the Emperor and the noble Empire. We have an honor, swift justice for the innocent. Nice, that's interesting. Not swift justice for the guilty, swift justice for the innocent. Our unbreakable bond to our brothers and Legion, unshakable courage in the face of death, the spread of civilization and culture, capital C civilization and capital C culture to all people everywhere, assuming that they don't have it, right? This is one of the key assumptions of British imperialism and imperialism in general, is that other people don't have civilization and they don't have culture, and we have to bring it to them, right? Instead of the realization that everyone, whatever their culture is happening where they are. They're creating it. They don't need it to go and visit other people. But it's one of the evangelical natures of Western governments and Western civilizations and societies is you have to go visit everyone on your boats and then get money from them because of the stuff that they have. And you can actually value create a lot by doing that, but you know, that value kind of stays on the people doing it. We pledge to uphold the just and infallible imperial rule of law. Infallible. Wow. The idea that law is infallible. Okay. And to crush the wicked, those who would violate imperial law and defile imperial values. It's important to define who the wicked are and to serve all imperial citizens everywhere. This is our oath and sworn fealty to the Emperor and Emperor. Close, not take. I don't know what the take button is here.
Continue through to the next building and talk to Sellus Gravius.
Okay. I'm going to take a brief break. This has been great. Join the Imperial Legion. Except perhaps the Death Shed Legion at Fort Darius. Oh, great. Yeah, it's small. The text is small, the font is small. I can, move the window, but I don't know. There's another mod that changes the text. Maybe we should look up getting that one. I'll be right back. What's up? It's a ghost. Like your name. Ghost is always a strong name. I always wanted to, find a way to incorporate it. Imperial Legion, move along. Genesil Dawar. You should learn how to do combat. Yeah. No. Yes, I agree. Pick up the dagger on the table by activating it with spacebar. Okay, so it is spacebar. Iron dagger. Pick the dagger by dropping it on your picture in the inventory menu. Okay. Need ingredients by equipping them on your character in the inventory menu. Ingredients have different properties. Some may hurt you and some may help. Oh, wow. Okay. Press F to pull out your weapon. Once your weapon is ready, hold and release the left mouse button to swing it. The harder you swing it, the more damage it does, but the more fatigue will drain. So it does pause the menu. Survived 3 years. That's the time I spent wandering throughout the islands of Arfandel. During my travels, I observed a lot of peculiar things, and I thought I'd share my experiences. Down below, I've listed some of my observations. Good luck, stranger. Grand Soul Gems are truly difficult to come by. Make sure you use them wisely. Fair enough. Enchanting items with constant effect enchantments require souls from powerful and unique enemies. Nice. Finding ore and gathering muck require specific tools, in this case a miner's pick and a muck shovel. City gates and shops closes at night. Inns, guild halls, and other places of interest are always open for business. I think that changed in Morrowind Reborn. Some creatures do not contain the same amount of soul essence as their natural counterparts. Nice. Merchants have very limited selection of rare ingredients. Due to imperial bureaucrats here on Vardenfell, it's illegal for outlanders to own more than one property. Oh, really? It can be circumvented if you race through the ranks of various guilds located on the island. Okay, that seems good. If you are a valued member of the Mage's Guild, You use special magic platforms inside guild halls to travel between guilds. Nice. Being able to haggle is a valuable skill. Taunting or any other way of annoying people will quickly end a conversation. Getting a high bounty will draw the attention of bounty hunters. Okay. Seems good. Plain paper. Bread. Everything belongs to me. Pick a low leaf. Get some jelly, some scuttle. Okay. The firmament. Serpent has no season, for it moves about in the heavens, usually threatening one of the other constellations. Huh. Arrogant and absent-minded mood. Such a good sound. Now I have a map menu. It shows you the name of the place you are and in and facing. Prisoners arriving later today, to process quickly and without entrance. Male, Rosmer male, Alper female. Prisoners. Fair male. Huh. Wow, each mushroom is different. Okay, that's something. I'll just... Okay. Yeah, E is jump. I kind of want to change that. Magic menu. You can see all your power spells and magic items. Click all menus. Right click to use your new menu. Click the spell or magic item you want to make your active magic. Press R to ready your active magic and click to cast. Very weak. Grand creature. Elemental burst. Whoa, nice. Frost fire, and that's cool. Rain fatigue. Reflect. Nice. Store health. Sanctuary. I wonder what that is. the skeleton minion. 15 seconds. Nice. Or fatigue on target. I got used to that spacebar thing. Proceed to talk to Captain Selectops to ask him about. Don't try persuasion on him if you're not good at it. He'll start to dislike you. Pretty funny. Identification papers, thank you. You've heard this from yesterday. So is Gravis. My background is not important. I'm here to welcome you to Morrowind. Yes, you're in Morrowind. I don't know why you're here, why you're released from prison ship to your reauthorization comes directly from Emperor Uriel Septon the Seventh himself, and I don't need to know any more than that. When you leave this office, you are a free man, but before you go, I have instructions for your duties. Instructions from the Emperor, so pay careful attention. Yeah, Uriel Emperor is still the Emperor. According to my instructions, you personally authorize your release from prison and your delivery here. It's all very mysterious, but that's the way the Empire works. Silence, secrecy. Not let the left hand know what the right hand is doing. Of course, this is the Empire. Ardenfell District of Morrowind. Been part of the Empire for 400 years. The current Emperor is Uriel Septon, 24th of the Septon line. You've been in prison that long, have you? Nothing wrong with your head, is there? And said you were acting a little strange when you brought up on the ship. Personally authorize your release from prison. Okay. Alright, your journal's been updated. Directions to Kaya's Kosades has been added to your inventory. Package for Kaya's Kosades inventory, 87 gold. Can't tell you where to find him, but you were to go to the South Wall Corner Club and ask for him. Someone there can direct you to him. Knight Errant of the Order of Ebonheart. With an Imperial Emissary attached to the Census and Excise Office here. Alright. Wow, I forgot just how, like, old these things are. Belmar is north of Sidonine. The road passes Pilgrad. The village crosses a deep ravine, passes Fort Moonmoth. Turns... That's such a cool word. Dark Souls has a moon moth, and I love it. Then turns west across the Odai River into Balmora. Okay. South Wall Corner Club is southeast Balmora on the east side of the river. For more detailed directions, talk to Elone, the scout at Ariel Straight House in Sydney, but take my advice. You're new here. Take the Silt's Treader to Balmora. It's fast, cheap, and safe. Cross the bridge and head east. Can't miss it. Alright, nice advice there. God, I want this font to be bigger. Yeah.
Well, where did I put that?
And I want this minimap to be bigger. And I want this to be bigger. I'm gonna stop the stuff here. We've been going for about 2 hours. I hope it's good, and I hope you guys like it. We're going to come back, hopefully, with better font size. And, yeah, I'll see you guys later. All right, peace.